Watch your mouth.
I'm trying to keep it
down. Oh, well, I'll try and be quiet then.
And welcome to our baccalaureate ceremony. It is my pleasure to introduce Reverend Don Hughes, who is the pastor at First Parish Federated Church here in South Berwick. She's been a longtime friend of Berwick Academy to our local community and to me and my family this year. I would invite you to please rise as she will begin our ceremony this evening with an invocation.
Thank you. It's good to see you again.
being connected to such an event. And although you won't hear much Latin tonight, baccalaureate is the beginning. It is the initiation of commencement. It is tonight that we have the opportunity to honor members of the class of 2008. And although this is a special night for me and for the faculty, I know that many others assembled here, parents, grandparents, special family friends, are beaming with pride right now at the sight of their senior up here on the stage. This is a special moment, and I encourage you to savor it. Before we begin, I want to thank Pat McManus and her building's crew for their attention to detail and setting everything up tonight. Judith Claveau, the assistant to the head of school, who has done a great job coordinating the awards process from start to finish, and also to Jim Sullivan, who provided valuable insight and guidance about this ceremony. I also want to thank my colleagues seated in these seats right here in the front rows. Your work in the classrooms, the athletic fields, the art studios, and the countless other mediums has shaped this class, the class of 2008. Your support, your respect, and your challenge have helped propel these young men and women to greater heights, and you have propelled them well for the challenges ahead. I know the students in front of you and the parents back of you recognize your special commitment, both personally to the students and to Berwick Academy. Thank you very much.
Now we begin. I would like to call Mr. Schneider to the podium
never missed a day of school during his entire career at Berwick Academy, Evan Ryan.
Thank you.
Jefferson scholars enjoy the journey and the quest for knowledge, for life experience, for involvement, but most of all, for excellence. Jefferson scholars are nominated by their high school, and the process begins with an extensive written application. Students whose qualifications are exceptional are then invited to interview with the regional committee. Each state may choose one scholar to submit to the finalist round. 100 finalists from around the United States and the world were selected to attend the Jefferson Scholars Retreat on the campus of the University of Virginia, and of these, only 40 were awarded the title of Jefferson Scholar. This scholars program covers the full cost of attending the University of Virginia for 4 years. In addition, scholars are eligible for special research and study programs and are matched with faculty mentors throughout their time at UVA. Please join me in honoring our Jefferson Scholar, Mary Olivia Hutton.
Rarely is it the case that new ground is broken by adults, let alone students. year's mathematics recipient did just that. He has set the bar for future mathematics students whose intellectual independence by suggesting a different method of algebraically manipulating the Taylor series. In the words of his calc teacher, these suggestions literally stopped me short and left my jaw dangling. When these suggestions were posted on the AP Calculus Internet bulletin board, many other teachers expressed amazement. I have had the pleasure in AP Physics of experiencing this student's ability to sort through and filter out ideas at lightning speed. One of the most challenging aspects of this class is the decision-making process between the multitude of different inferential procedures. This student made it look easy. He quickly recognized the nuances of the questions and came to the correct solutions time after time. He is the first Berwick Academy student ever to participate in all 4 years of the main state math meet, which means that he qualified as one of the top 10 students at the school since his freshman year. He is also a two-time state champion. In his coursework, he is the only member of the graduating class to have completed AP Mathematics Trifecta, AP Calculus AB, AP Calculus BC, and AP Statistics. His college letters of recommendation describe him as having creative and original thought and a beautiful mind. It's my pleasure to present this year's honor in mathematics to Keegan Huntley.
Biology to San Peter. mademoiselle, messieurs, bonsoir. Among the very gifted and very dedicated students in French this year, and over the past 4 years, one approached the language with extraordinary gusto and constant good humor. Her enthusiasm translated into consistently writing more than required and taking risks in an effort to infuse her work in French with the same creative spirit she has known for in English. In order to improve her spoken intonation, her relative weakness, she chose to enroll in both AP and Advanced Oral Expression in her senior year. The results were fabulous. She placed highest in her class and fourth in the state of Maine this year in the level five National French Contest. I'm delighted to award this year's honor medal in French to Katie Edkins.
Freshman year. I'm speaking, of course, of Evan Brock, or as he is sometimes is known affectionately in jazz band hip-hop parlance, Ebrock. Evan has been determined, good-humored, curious, and always helpful to his brothers and sisters in the group, and thus very helpful to me. Lizanne Platt used another word to help define Evan in reference to his senior project, a musical he wrote for the third graders with Mr. Allen here at Berwick. His interactions with the students, Lizanne said, were always kind. It's going to be strange to not see you at the piano next fall, Evan. Good luck. And on behalf of everyone in the music department, congratulations.
Stands out
Cashin was a standout in my honors chemistry class as a sophomore 2 years ago. He skipped over chemistry as a junior, but recognized the error of his ways and returned to the chem lab this year as a member of my AP chemistry class. He has earned solid A's all year while wowing classmates with his recollection of small facts discussed in one day in chemistry 2 years before. He has backed up these feats with impressive results in standardized exams. As Olivia Hutton had before him, Emil scored the highest mark in the state on this year's chemistry Olympiad exam. The average score of all the second-year chemistry students taking this test is a 24 out of 60. Emil scored 53 out of 60 on this very challenging test. The chemistry AP exam is also well known for its difficulty. A student must earn 100 out of a possible 160 points in order to earn the top score of 5. And nationally, only 17% of students taking this test are able to manage this. On an AP exam given in class, Emil scored an amazing 150 out of 160. Apart from test scores, Emil also demonstrates an unrivaled attention to detail that sets him apart. During a lab early this year, my class was forced to use two different sized test tubes when using a piece of specialized equipment. As a class, we hypothesized that the main source of error in this experiment was the difference in size between the two tubes. Emil took this discussion a step further. He made the necessary measurements, calculated the difference in diameters of the two test tubes, performed the math operations needed to calculate the theoretical error in using the two different tubes, and he validated our assertion that the different size mattered. Both your classmates and I have been so impressed with the outstanding work in all areas of AP chemistry. On behalf of them and our science department, I'm pleased to name you as the recipient of the Chemistry Award for this year.
Chapter of the Triad Music Honor Society. We would like to honor a student who has achieved outstanding musical
We learned last night that in middle school, her screen name was Future Author 911. She is the elder half of a dynamic pair of sisters who revived our upper school literary magazine through vision and a lot of hard work. Her senior project this spring was producing a memoir and assisting lower school authors in their Literacy and Young Authors Day programs, and whose papers in history and English are always a joy to read, beautifully crafted, engaging, and always refreshingly insightful, and drawn, as all good writers know, from the joy of learning and the wonder of life. And I'm pleased to give the Perkins Award to Katie Atkins.
She not only sees others, she cares about them and cares enough to take action. An outreach leader this year, Olivia Hutton, has been actively organizing service-related events in our community. In a few days, 10 Berwick students will be headed down to Louisville, Kentucky to help Berwick alum Rachel Davis, Ian's sister, run an environmental day camp for sixth graders in an underprivileged school called Lassiter Middle School. This project has been a year-long effort with over 100 buddy partners from Berwick corresponding with Lassiter students, culminating in this final trip. We hope this partnership becomes a long-lasting one between our schools, and I attribute this program's momentum to her. Olivia has been a key player in the New Green Committee this year. She organized a group of students, activists to canvas at local Step It Up initiatives to decrease carbon emissions, and coordinated a trip for students to tour the New Hampshire State Capitol with her local state representative. A member of her local youth group, Olivia has gained confidence as a leader with energy and voice. Olivia's kind spirit, her keen perception of people, and the powerful message she sends through her leadership is inspiring to all of us. Congratulations. Step off the bike to make the steep ascent back up Fog Hill. Ben has volunteer for Bill Richardson's campaign this fall. He wielded a mean hammer on the March Habitat for Humanity trip last year up in Portland and was climbing into holes in walls for photo shoots. He has been an active tutor and mentor at the Seymour Osman Center in Dover for 3 years and is known there for his keen math prowess, his gentle spirit, and his amazing skills at Connect Four. In all, it's Ben's intrepid and independent spirit and his sense of urgent activism that have inspired us. And we are thankful for his many contributions both on and off the hilltop.
Mark. Since his middle school days, he has gone on. He has participated in multiple New England tournament games. He may be the only player ever to compete in New England tournament games in soccer, hockey, and lacrosse in the same year. He scouted both soccer and lacrosse teams, then a first team All-League selection in soccer, and a two-time selection in lacrosse. He was named Foss's Dream Team Soccer Player of the Year and played in the New England All-Star Lacrosse Game. For his natural ability, continued pursuit of excellence, and outstanding leadership, it is my pleasure to present the Hilltop Award to Keaton Malhorn.
Thank you.
This young leader has led her class in an effort to support disadvantaged children, and she has even come before the Board of Trustees to articulate how we could all do a better job in the area of service. There is nothing that a head of school cherishes more than a student who finds a way to challenge and improve the institution while always maintaining a level of respect and personal excellence that makes her voice simply impossible to ignore. A national merit finalist, she will be missed deeply on this campus next year. However, Berwick Academy's loss will be Virginia's gain, as she was awarded the prestigious Jefferson Scholarship this spring, including 4 fully funded years of undergraduate education at Thomas Jefferson's beloved campus. Given her personal commitment to service, I can think of no stronger person to embody not only Jefferson's ideals, but those of our own Berwick Academy as she moves forward. It is my distinct honor to award our first head of school prize this evening to Olivia Hutton.
As president of the senior class, he spent the year not only advocating on behalf of
sometimes overt, sometimes subtle, but always present. What I appreciated the most about him is not his keen wit or his infectious smile, but his sense of possibility. Ladies and gentlemen, Christian Robbins.
Finally, right.
fortunate to have numerous musical talents in the class of 2008. In honor of her class, and especially for tonight's baccalaureate, Lisa Gratian has prepared a Celtic piece entitled She Beat She More. Lisa. Many of my colleagues had dropped by the office to introduce themselves, and perhaps misses on the first week of class. Is that okay? Now, honestly, I was a bit stunned. This is not the typical approach when meeting a new director. Usually one would ease into the situation, but Brian was kind of excited, and he wasn't going to wait. I could see a little twinkle in his eyes and hear quite a spirit in his voice. Plus, I knew he could probably blow up my office with his chemistry skills. I've seen him teach. I've seen him coach. Passion pervades everything this man does. And tonight, by vote of the senior class, he is our baccalaureate speaker, Mr. Sanborn.
Celebrate my favorite of the Berwick senior year ceremonies. Fall convocation is meaningful to be sure. Seeing members of the class in cap and gown early in the year is a powerful visual reminder that this is the group of seniors, of students that have risen to the top of their academic food chain. Convocation empowers the class to be leaders for the coming school year. Graduation is a ritual we use to declare that the class is finished with the point them in an outward direction, and the class spreads out to the winds. There's a finality about graduation that I just did not like. In between these two ceremonies is baccalaureate. The ceremony is personal, it's emotional, it's full of opportunities to recognize members of the senior class in a positive way. It's time to celebrate the memories of the past, and we don't have to say goodbye quite yet. So to the headmaster, the upper school director, Reverend Muse, the board of trustees, faculty, staff, the class of 2008, and to your family and friends, I say welcome to the amazing night that is baccalaureate. Let's cherish the time we have while it's here, and let's not wish it away too quickly. I spoke on a baccalaureate night a few years ago for the first time, and on that occasion, the words came quickly and easily to me. I knew exactly what I wanted to say. This time around, the process was much more difficult for me, and it did not take me long to realize why. I've taught 46 of the 67 members of this class, 13 of them for 2 years. I've coached 10 of their members at one point or another. I'm the advisor to one, along with Madame Clinton, a class advisor to all. I know your laughs, your mannerisms, and I can usually pick out which one of you sneeze by the unique sound you make when this happens. This class is full of people I know and admire, people I count as friends and who I see as heroes and heroines. I'm greatly honored to give this talk to you. The speech has been very difficult for me to write because I think highly of you, and I just don't want to let you down. Tonight I ask you to think with me about pathways. These are choices we make that lead us in a direction and often involve life-altering consequences, though we often did not see this at the time. When we were young, most of us had hopes and dreams of what we wanted to be when we got older. Meg Platt wanted to be an astronaut. Megan Ramsey, a pizza girl. Margaret Grew wanted to work at a toll booth so she could keep all the money. Sarah Foster and Kim Tumeyer wanted to be lawyers because they were so good at arguing. Shelby Smith considered herself to be the fastest runner in the world and knew that she would grow up to be an incredible athlete. Abby Lang felt she would be a professional biker since she was so good at dodging potholes. Among the class, we had those who would be professional athletes in hockey, soccer, and baseball, Olympians in horse riding, gymnastics, and figure skating, trainers of horses and dolphins, teachers, cartoonists, policemen, and even a James Bond. For different reasons, most of the members of the class have set aside these dreams of the past for now and have chosen new ones. Members of the class of 2008 are currently hoping to be psychologists, writers, animators, performers,
Some want to be overseas, and some want to be in the Peace Corps. They wish to have jobs of selfless service. They wish to go to med schools. They'd like to be on Jeopardy. They'd like to have no job and live on a beach. All of these sound really good to me. One of my favorite things to do is to sit down with a person and listen to their life story as to how they came to be who they are. I remember having career days at my school when people of different professions were brought in to speak with kids about career choices. I find that most people like to talk about this and think back fondly on some of the events that led them to their calling in life. I encourage you to bring up this sort of things in conversations with parents and grandparents and acquaintances. The moments that follow will be memorable ones, both for the listener and for the speaker. As much as I like listening to these talks, I never really considered myself as the speaker until this past summer. Something happened last summer that really made me look back on my own life for the first time and evaluate the pathways I had chosen. I hope as you listen to some of my story, that you'll consider your own, for I bet that each person out here has a great story to tell. This past summer, I got a letter out of the blue from my high school sweetheart. I was pretty much petrified of girls back in middle and high school days. Not much has changed, actually. But one girl named Amy sort of latched onto me, and we spent quite a bit of time during my junior and senior years in high school. Everyone thought we were the perfect couple, and we were sure to be married. It did not work out that way. I graduated and went off to college. She had one more year of high school. We gradually drifted off and did not cross paths for close to 30 years. Anyway, she lives in San Diego now with her family, as does my older sister, Julie. To make a long story short, the two of them ran into each other, got to talking, and Amy decided to look me up when she vacationed in Maine last summer. The two of us spent about 5 hours, probably some sort of record for me, talking about our high school days and what happened to each of us thereafter. You cannot go through something like this without being forced to take a good hard look at the choices, the events, the whims, and the other seemingly inconsequential incidences that have molded your life. When I was little, I wanted to be a member of the Boston Red Sox. I knew all the players' names, I got to go to Fenway about once a year, and I listened to or saw nearly all their games on either the radio or TV. I grew up on a large dairy farm, and the closest kid my age who wasn't a family member lived between 2 and 3 miles away. Obviously, if I was going to be a professional baseball player, I would have to learn much of the game on my own. I found a rubber ball, and I spent hours after chores throwing this ball against the side of the house. If I threw it directly at the cement foundation, I could get practice with ground balls. If I threw the ball so it would short off the wall, I could catch fly balls. When my arm gets sore, I would hit by throwing the ball up in the air and whacking it. I would play 2 full games each day, 1 pitching and 1 hitting. The Red Sox versus a particular opponent of the day. I knew all the lineups and would pitch or bat accordingly, depending on the hitter, and then see in the game that night how my predicted outcome turned out. Because the Red Sox always won my games. I had some good days on real baseball fields growing up, and was a pitcher on a state championship team in high school. I hoped to play in college, but a pathway led me in a different direction. My younger sister's kidneys had failed. She needed a transplant, and I was the best match in my family. Our operation would happen 5 days after my high school graduation, and baseball was put aside. It would be 23 years later, in an over 30s men's league, when I got to step up on a mound again for the next time. Just as an aside, the kidney transplant was successful, and my sister is alive and well today. We'll celebrate our 30th anniversary of our surgery in 2 weeks' time. It was a miracle. Thoughts of the baseball career were over, and it was time to think about which college to attend. I only looked at 2 schools, Colby College and the University of Maine in Orono. Both of these had some kind of calling for me. I had spent a summer at UMO taking a chemical engineering course through the Maine Pulp and Paper Foundation. This group offered me a scholarship to become a chemical engineer and to work for a paper company in northern Maine after graduation. I decided against my father's wishes to keep my options open and attend Colby instead. My high school chemistry teacher, who was highly my sophomore year, I inquired about taking some education courses. At the time, Colby had kind of a unique education program where student teaching was done in elementary schools during sophomore year, at middle schools during junior year, and high schools during senior year. The courses all seemed to fit into gaps in my schedule. I wound up with a triple major after my 4 years at Colby. My next big choice involved job selection after college. I was offered a terrific math-related job working for New England Telephone and its affiliates, which would have involved much money, job security, and the promises of a good life somewhere in the Carolinas. Against my father's wishes, I turned down this job, and I looked at teaching jobs instead. I eventually was offered three positions. One way up Maine, as the whole math and science department at a small school. I was offered a second job at my hometown high school, and a third as a chemistry teacher and baseball coach at Trait Academy in Kittery. I took the job at Trait, and have basically been a teacher and a coach in this area ever since. To be sure, there have been many pathways and many choices since then, but this speech has become a little too long, and it's time to move on to better things. To the class of 2008, you've already begun the process of choosing your pathways in life. You've already made some of the choices that will affect you in great and unexpected ways. I hope that each one of you will be able to look back at your story someday. I hope you'll laugh at yourself, but I also hope that you will know you made the right choices for you. It's okay to have some regrets. It's okay to wonder where other pathways might have led. It's also very okay to be happy with where you are. I hope when you're 48 and others around you are having midlife crises, you'll feel okay with the choices you've made. On Senior Arts Night, Hannah Kuhn and Megan Ramsey sung a wonderful duet that touched many of us who were there. A refrain from that song seems especially appropriate to use as a closing here tonight. They sang